Okay, so let's leave our hardcore lead hacking topics aside for a while and talk about the whole other story, the whole other facet of modern ethical hacking and hacking alike. So let's discuss social engineering. So in the beginning, I should warn you that this topic deserves a whole separate training to be only partially covered in order for you to grasp the amount of risk and the amplitude of threat that social engineering poses to modern cyberspace. So everyone most probably already knows this really arguable maxim, yeah, this really arguable statement that the weakest link of any security system is always a human being, right? So yeah, this is quite a popular phrase, and it can be heard from many different people with different experiences and levels of professionality. However, there are ways to mitigate human threat, and here we will discuss how, first of all, we could be able to exploit it and to what extent in order to stay within ethical boundaries. And second, we will certainly discuss how to possibly mitigate the amount of risk that is associated with human-related threats. Okay, so yeah, let's start. Let's start from some definitions and just shaping the concepts. So, I will not ask you to be empty jars, right, as many trainers do, because humans are social creatures, right? So until this point in your life, you had already had a lot of social interactions, so you have experience, and most of you probably already know all these things related to psychology, how brains work, its basic structure, and how different parts of it are responsible for different actions and classes of actions, and how reflexes are different from instincts, and how high brain activity is different from everything else. So that's just something we consume from our education process, but we are not always able to employ all this knowledge within the cyberspace. Okay, so the main problem with social engineering is that people who are normally very good with dealing with threats, with physical threats, with environmental threats, with health issues, and so on, just because they have been told, yeah, evolutionarily or through education to deal with it, to deal with all these risks, are really bad when it comes to treating similar threats and similar risks in cyberspace. For one sole reason. Saber-toothed tigers were living on the earth with us for a really long time. Yeah, and we have practically, by trial and error, have learned how to avoid them or how to fight them or whatever. Yeah, so how to be more or less safe from them. And computers are with us for a little more than 40 years. Okay, and networks are prominent even for the last time. So practically there were no time sufficient to learn all these things. For older people, it's a bigger problem. For younger people, it's less of a problem just because they are growing up in this environment and they already have all this knowledge and they are more technically savvy and so on. And there were very few cases of formal education, especially en masse, of these concepts and tools and tricks and possible attack vectors, right? So people are not aware. Knowledge is not important. People just are not aware of what can happen. And if you go out there and talk to some non-security people, you will understand what I'm talking about. Yeah, so CEO fraud, for example, is a thing, and $3 billion are lost only in reported incidents since 2015. Yeah, but business people are still not aware that this is possible. They still believe that internal controls and external audits could save you from that. Let's discuss this in more detail later. But for now, I have to make you admit to yourself that this is a thing, and we as security community and security industry are not doing enough for educating and promoting awareness through the masses. Okay, so what we do instead, we focus on separating the responsibility of security related issues, yeah, and the user. So we are trying to put the user aside from the responsibility from his or her actions. Okay, so this is what is the main meaning to me, at least, of this phrase by Bruce Schneier, right? Amateurs hack systems, professionals hack people. Because systems are okay, they are quite quickly developed, and they are developed by different people, and they combine different technologies, and always when different technologies meet, there is some intersection, there inevitably will be security problems. And the main point where security problems arise is this intersection between a human being and the technology that he or she uses. Okay, so this difference between the internals of these two things, a human being and the machine, they result in all sorts of security issues. So what is social engineering in security meaning, yeah, in security plane? So to my opinion, and believe me, I dig a lot of information related to social engineering in my life. The best definition and the most constructive definition was given by joint effort of FBI and DHS a few years ago. They have issued a joint report, and they have shaped the definition as that the social engineering is the threat of unmotivated insider. Okay, so what a motivated insider is, we all know, right? So someone is just committing internal fraud, or is paid for giving out some information, performing some actions. Yeah, so this is a malicious insider, yeah? And he is motivated, he or she is motivated to some extent by goods or by threatening, I don't know, whatever. So he or she is performing deliberately. What social engineering is operating within these limits, yeah? So we do not motivate an insider, we trick him, we influence him somehow to perform actions or disclose information. Okay, what do we do for that? Of course, we have to operate over some data, and for that we use reconnaissance techniques, all these open source intelligence things that we have already discussed in early videos, yeah? So in order to proceed with social engineering attack modeling, we have to collect a lot of information. First of all, we have to identify all those people, then we have to know more about those people, about their interactions, about their close and relatives and friends and family and so on. Their hobbies, their desires and passions and interests, and who they play golf with and so on. So this is the basis. We have to do that the good way. So we have to collect a lot of information. Then we have to be psychologists to some extent. So most people think they know some psychology just because they operate within social environments. But in fact, when you touch even the basic 101 course on psychology, which I recommend to every security person, yeah, you understand that that is simply not correct. People have a lot of misunderstanding of what psychology is, of what psychoanalysis is, What is clinical psychology, what is social psychology, behavioral psychology, and so on. And moreover, these concepts are always changing. Social psychology and behavioral psychology are the thing right now. However, the very popular books on that were unsold on Amazon for many years, and now they are suddenly becoming bestsellers because there is a lot of public interest to it. So yeah, go there and read the book, you know. And then we will discuss some psychology. I'm just kidding. That's okay to know only the basic concepts to operate over social engineering engagements. But in order to master them, you definitely will need some basic training. I hope you will find the source that will be credible enough, like well-respected university or professional author. Okay, so this leaves us in a little bit of ambiguity, right? So is social engineering really science or is it a bit of art? I would say it's a little bit of both. I wouldn't say that is art explicitly and is limited to this concept. Yeah, so I do not believe that this requires any talent. This is a skill. It could and should be trained. And it is not a science yet, too, because it employs little gray area things that are not yet covered with the scientific psychology approach. Yeah, so there were no formal scientific research that covers all these things. Yeah, so there is some observational research, there is some surveying, but that's not enough. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about when I'm trying to ground the people who think they know psychology when really they don't. That's a science. There is a science method there, and in order to state something, you have to conduct a lot of research. But social engineering is just a thing. It's there for some time, but it's still an emerging threat, and there is not much of scientific research conducted over the population that is facing social engineering threat on the internet. Yeah, so we have statistics about the incidents, but we have not conducted scientific experimentation programs yet. So the tools and the methods that are to be used during social engineering penetration tests could be split to two categories. Yeah, so there is some high-tech human hacking, let's use this wording, and human ethical hacking, of course. Yeah, and there is some low-tech human ethical hacking. So we will discuss those in more detail. And I'm leaving you in the end of this slide with even more ambiguity regarding social engineering. So the cool game social engineers have when they gather in quantities more than two, yeah, is asking each other questions and arguing about whether social engineering always employs lying, providing incorrect or untruthful information to the target. Okay, so there are different positions. Yeah, some people say that it is possible not to lie and still be successful in social engineering engagements, and some people are completely sure that that is not possible. At some point you will just have to lie. And this is basically the point where you will have to use some verbal communication skills and the non-verbal communication skills that will prevent your target from uncovering your pretext and actually figuring out that you are trying to social engineer them. Okay, so yeah, this is the problematics and basic concepts that we will discuss in this section. So yeah, let's start it out.